Hello, welcome to the Empire of Dirt workshop. Today I'm going to be working on a BH2. This is a BHTU scope. This is one I bought back in 2018. Bought it and overhauled it back then. So at the time I did a complete overhaul, tore it all down, overhauled everything. The one thing I did not do, because I didn't have a good way to do it at the time, but the one thing I did not do is substage collimation. So today I'm going to take it apart and do that, but that's not really the subject of this video. What I'm going to do though is, while I have this apart to do that collimation, is I'm going to make a modification to the electronics on this thing. Back here we got our AC power input. I'm going to put a fuse holder right here. Now the reason I'm going to put that fuse holder in is because if you look at the BH2 schematic on the 20 watt versions here, you'll see that if you have a 240 volt scope, there's a fuse holder in it. If you have a 120 volt North American model, actually they call it a 110, 115. If you have this model here, there is no fuse in there, so there's nothing to protect in the event of a failure. There's nothing to protect the power transformer in here. And that is, in my mind, that's kind of the weak link on this design, because I can replace anything else if I have to. I can lay out a circuit board or whatever to replace anything in the base. The only thing that I can't replace is that transformer, because it's got such an oddball form factor. I couldn't find one that would fit in there if I had to. So I'm going to put a fuse holder in here. And at that point, I won't have any concerns that any reasonable fault's ever going to cause that power transformer to go bad. Okay, first thing I want to do is I want to pull the electrical base out of this thing, so that number one, I can do the collimation, which I'll do that off camera. You don't have to watch that. I've got another video showing how the collimation is done. But anyway, to get this electrical base up, first thing you do is remove the lamp house, just pull it straight out, and set it aside, making sure you don't touch the bulb in the process, because you get oils on there, and that will cause the bulb to prematurely fill if you run it really hot. Okay, next thing I do is I basically just lay this guy on its back so that I have access to these four screws here, and take a 4mm hex tool, go into these screws and take them out. Two more. And the last one. Okay, now I'm going to take a magnet, pull these guys out. I think that one's still actually engaged a little bit, since the magnet didn't grab it. There we go. Okay, so I've got all four screws out. Set those aside. Okay, so what I want to do is I'm going to grab this and just hold this base in place. Oh, I put the stand in its normal setup. It's normally, you know, its normal upright position on the work surface. And then just grab the pillar arm and lift it straight up and set this guy aside for safekeeping. Okay, so here is the electrical base. Let's try to give you a better view of that. AC power comes in on this jack here, goes through these wires to this power transformer here. This is the one that I'm worried about. If anything fails, like this bridge rectifier here, if that guy ever shorts, such that there's a short across the secondary on this thing, this guy would smoke, and that would be the end of this base. So what I'm going to do is, there's a hole here, as you can see, hole right here in the chassis. There's a little cover over that, a little plate covering that up, but there's a hole there that is perfect for this fuse holder right here. This is a fuse holder for a 5x20mm glass fuse. Fuses of this variety here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to remove that plate, install a fuse holder here, and then make a minor wiring change to put that in the circuit. And at that, from that point on, this will be protected, and I don't think I ever have to worry about that transformer going bad again. So the first thing I want to do is try to get this plate off. I say try, I guess one way or another. Hell or high water, I'm going to get this plate off. I'm going to try to get it off intact so that the plate could be reused. if I could do that, then this would be a reversible change. But either way, I'm going to get her off. So take a little VHA, very small screwdriver, and I'm just going to press it in there to try to open up just a little bit of a gap, if I can do that. Okay, so now that is open just a little bit. I got it behind there on the one end. And what I'm going to try to do, I don't know if it's going to work or not, but I got some I've got alcohol. I'm going to try to just drizzle a little of that alcohol back there, and with any luck, that'll soften up this glue enough to let me take this thing off. So, let's put a little of that in there. Give it a little time to work. As I go through, pry it a little more. Alright, so that's step one. Next thing I'm going to try, I've got a little bit of dental floss. Cut off a piece of that, and my plan is to, I don't know if it's going to work or not, but I'm going to see. Try to put this back here and try to shear off that glue bond, that layer of adhesive, and try to shear that off. And it kind of seems to be working. I think I just need to periodically add more alcohol in there so that I can dissolve the new layers of adhesive as they're revealed as I go through this process. So let's put that in there. Yeah, I don't know if you can see it or not, but I am making a little bit of progress. It is kind of coming through there. Cool. Seems like this is actually working. I'll put a little more alcohol in there for the glue. And see if we can pull it through and cut that thing off there. Getting close. And of course it broke. Okay, I've got another piece. Give her another go. You can see that it's pretty much off of there. Alright. I call that a success. All I got to do if I ever want to reuse this thing is clean that all off and reattach it. So I guess before I go too much further, I want to see if I can clean off all this mess, this adhesive here. Seemed like the alcohol did kind of dissolve it and soften it. Maybe I have better luck if I can use acetone on it now. So what I'm going to try is I'm just going to take this little acid brush, this brush here. Obviously it's seen better days. So it's a perfect one to use on something like this. I'm just going to cover this, try to keep the acetone off of this plastic here. I don't want to dissolve the plastic, but I do want to just get some of this on the top here and see whether it's doing any good or not. And the answer is, yeah, it's definitely softening this and allowing it to come off. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to go off camera, spend a few minutes, get this cleaned up. Hopefully the next time you see it, it'll be clean and ready to go. Okay, got it pretty well cleaned off. I did change my strategy just a little bit. I decided I wasn't going to use acetone because it was just too close to this plastic. So instead, I switched to mineral spirits, and that worked as well, if not better. So I think that's pretty well clean, and we're ready to go to the next step. Okay, so what I need to do now is I need to, this black wire here, I need to disconnect that black wire. Let me go back and explain a little bit. Coming in here, we have three pins coming in on this electrical cable. This center one here on the top goes to this green wire, this green and yellow bond wire, and that's a critical wire that needs to always be bonded to this metal chassis. As you can see, it goes from that terminal, screws hard right there. And don't ever use one of these things if that connection is impaired, because that's a safety connection. If there's ever any fault that tries to energize this housing, which would be your entire scope if you're operating it, that would be connected to ground and would cause your breaker to open up in the wiring, and so that would be a safe incident, a safe fault. Whereas if you didn't have that, this thing would be energized, and you might get the ride of your life if you try to use the scope at that point. So never operate one without this connection. Having said that, what I'm going to try to do is I'm going to try to cut this black connection, because that's the so-called line wire coming in. That's 120 volts relative to this ground connection, and also 120 volts relative to this white neutral connection. There is no significant voltage between this white wire and this green wire. However, there is a huge voltage, 120 volts specifically, between the black wire and the green wire, or between the black wire and the white wire. I don't know whether that was comprehensible or not, but anyway, the point is, it's the black wire I want to interrupt, because that's the one that's actually got the live voltage on it. So I want to put the fuse holder in series with that, so that if the fuse opens up, that voltage is removed from this black connection. And that way, if there's ever a fault where this black connection is inadvertently tied to the chassis, that fuse will open up and prevent that. So let's proceed. Now, the first thing I want to do is take out these two screws here, because that black wire is kind of hard to get to, because it's got the green wire on top of it. I'd like to get it to the point, I don't know if I can or not, but I'd like to get it to the point where I can have better access to that black wire to make the changes I need. So step one is to take out these two screws. And now that I've done that, what I'd like to do is pull this guy out a little bit, but as you can see, it's not really going anywhere, because this black wire, this white wire here, the white neutral wire, and the black line wire especially are tight, and that's preventing it from coming out. If you follow them over, they go behind the transformer here. They come over here, and they're tied down by this little zip tie here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the zip tie out of there, like so. And now, in theory, shut up, Alexa. Okay, that gives me just a little bit more slack. Sorry if my hands are in the way, but there's a little bit more slack there in those wires now. And now it seems like they may be being pinched or held by the transformer here, so I may have to pull the transformer loose too. So let's do that. There's four screws on this transformer. Two of them hold them in, and the other two do not. If these ones that are, in this case, the ones that are silver, the ones that are kind of brass colored, do not take those out, but these other two you do need to take out. And you want to make sure you get a JIS screwdriver that really fits them. Maybe I'll take a second to explain what that means. If you look at this, here's a screwdriver I first tried. Put it in there. I was going to try to loosen it there, but see that little bit of wiggle? That's suicide to try to take out a JIS screw on one of these guys when you've got that kind of wiggle in the driver. You'll round it out as often as not, and that screw will not come out, and then you've got a problem. This one here has a bigger tip. Fits properly, and there is no motion there. So given that, I feel confident to try to take this screw out. Yeah, and it's coming out fine. Let's back up just a little bit. We're probably in too close. Okay, now the next one I want to take out is this one, and it's under these wires. So if I hold the wires out of the way, yeah, that got it. Cool. Sometimes these can be kind of stubborn, but usually they're not too bad. Alright, so those guys are out of the way. Now I can pull this guy out. You can see these other two screws, why we didn't take them out, because they're just holding these laminations on this transformer together. So you really don't want to take those out. And underneath here, there's a little rubber. I don't know if it's rubber or what it is, but a a compliant pad that holds that thing to keep vibration down a little bit. But the bottom line is now we can see what's going on. If we take this out, we can see what's going on in these wires and get them out of here. And now, as I wanted, we have a little bit better access here. So what's holding up now is this green bonding connection that I told you never to take off. Hell, I'll just stand it up and then you can see it. This green connection here, I'm going to take that loose just so that I can pull this out, but I'm going to be 100% sure that I put that back in before I operate this scope again. That needs to be in, and it needs to be secure, and that wire needs to be undamaged at the same time. Okay, so it's out, and now I do have pretty good access to this guy. So what I need to do is I need to cut this black wire here, and I'm going to cut it absolutely as long as I can, as close to this connection as I can, because if I get it too short, then I have to extend it to reach the fuse holder, and I totally don't want to do that. It looks like, in theory, there should be enough wire here to do this without having to extend anything. And so that's the way I want to do it. Okay, so this is coming off relatively easily. Once that's off, then we can see what we're up against on how to trim that wire back. Okay, so there it is. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to reach in here, cut it right there, which is absolutely as close to this connection as I can. Get a grip on it and cut it. So now this black wire is open. So what I have to do now is I have to get up soldering iron and clean off the wires off this lug, and then we'll proceed to reassemble it. Okay, now to do some soldering and desoldering on this pin here that we just cut the black wire off of, I could just try to desolder it, and yeah, that'd be doable, but I have hopefully learned a few things being in the electronics industry for 40 years, and one of them is do whatever you can to make it easy on yourself. So what I'm going to do... I'm just going to take this little clamp here and I'm going to clamp this guy to the top of the bench so it doesn't go anywhere while I desolder this. Okay. Got my iron plugged in, hot, as you can see. I'm going to add just a little bit of fresh solder to this. And I don't want to overheat this too much because I don't want to melt this plastic housing, otherwise I have to replace the whole thing. Coming off. Okay. I think there's one more couple strands in there. Alright, that baby's off. So what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to tin this iron, set it aside. I can take the clamp off now. It's done its job. That would have been 10 times harder with this sucker flopping around while I was doing that. Okay, what I want to do now, I think, is start putting her back together. Okay, after shooting my mouth off about learning a few things being in the industry for 40 years, I took the clamp off too soon. I want to put the clamp back on so that it'll be there while I install the black wire onto this. So there we go. Now I have some black wire, same gauge and everything. I don't know what gauge it is. AWG. I think it says 14. I'm not even sure. Let's find out. Yes, AWG 14. If I take my AWG 14 strippers here, third hole back. If this is AWG 14, I'll get a nice strip without any damage. And that worked. So yeah, this is 14 gauge wire. One problem with having 40 years in the industry is you got eyes that are, well, 40 years too old. So it's hard to read the markings on the wire anymore. Okay. So before I even start to do anything, I've stripped this wire. Good practice is to tin the wires before you do anything with them. That way the strands don't separate and they stay intact. So what I want to do is take a little solder. And tin that wire. So that's in pretty good shape now. Grab some needle nose pliers here. What I want to do is put a little bit of a hook in this thing. Give me just a second. Okay, I just went off camera, and I just solder worked a little of that excess solder off here to make it a little easier to bend without breaking anything. Yeah, it's much better. So what I want to do is I want to hook it through there where it's going to go. Then I want to bite this down, close this down. And that way I have a nice, good mechanical connection. You always want a good mechanical connection before you solder. That supports the solder and does it so that you don't have stresses on the solder later. And otherwise, 10 years later, that connection could fracture and you'd have a cold solder connection. And you don't want that. Okay, so I'm going to go in here, touch a solder. And for now, I'm going to shut the iron off because I won't need it for a little bit. No reason to just sit there and let that tip cook. Okay, so now I'm going to take a little bit of black shrink tubing, heat shrink tubing, and I'm going to cut off about yay long of a piece. I'm going to slip that over this black wire. Take it down here. That's a little bit long. I want to shorten it just a little bit more. So if I can make it look like an amateur, if I can make it not look like an amateur did this, then that's the way I'd rather do it. We all know the truth. Okay, so that guy's in place. Need to get out the heat gun and shrink that down. Got my Harbor Freight heat gun that I bought 15 years ago and have used the hell out of it. It's been a good waste of $15. So let's get that shrunk down. Okay, now that heat shrink is shrunk down, we can proceed to reinstall this in there. Make sure we attach this to the casting, and we'll put it all back together. Okay, let's get rid of this for real this time. Let's get the screws to hold her in place. That would be this guy and this guy. And then we secure it down. Okay, that's in there. And now before I have a chance to forget about it, this green bond wire, safety bonding wire, is going back exactly where it needs to be, and it's going to be securely tied down, screwed down, using the starred washer that makes sure we have good electrical contact. That is to say, there's a screw here with a flat washer, a split washer, and that starred washer. That starred washer bites into it, and I just dropped the washer. Be right back. Okay, I have retrieved it. Put this in there. Get the right size screwdriver that fits this, because I am going to put a little torque on there to hold that down to make sure. I know that's hard for you to see, but it is going in. Is snug, is not going anywhere, will not be loosening up. So that scope is once again safe. At this point, I think I'm just going to put the transformer in so that that's not flopping around. As you can see, yeah. So what I want to do is I want to grab this vibration pad. Two holes here are enlarged and two are not, so the two big holes go in these two corners, the other two go there, like that. Take the hairs off of it. Dog hairs are everywhere. Okay, now before I do that, I should poke these in. There's a little channel here where they go in to protect them from being pinched. And I really should do that. I am running a little risk here that when I put this all together, I may not have quite as much room here to work on the fuse holders as I would like, but I think it's going to be okay. It'll be a little close, but it should work. Okay, now the pad goes in. Like that. So these big holes are basically clearance holes for the nuts on the back of the transformer. So when you put the transformer in, these nuts go into those big holes. Okay, now if that's lined up properly, I can take these two screws, put them in through these holes. Get the right screwdriver. And go ahead and tighten them down. Now once I've done that, transformer will be installed. Okay. So, we are getting close. Now, the way I'm going to route this, the white wire is going to come across here like it is. This black wire I think I can pull a little bit more out of it. Still get enough. So I think I can still route it like that and still get it to go. Okay, now this hole here, originally we had this plate here. I've made a sticker here. I'm going to see if I can make that work. I've got it basically the right size for to replace that plate. So what I want to do is stick it down there. Then I'm going to try, I don't know how this is going to work, but I'm going to try to just cut out this hole here with an X-Acto knife. So far, not so bad. Wow, that actually came out pretty cleanly. I'm surprised. Okay, so let's take this fuse holder. Loosen up hardware. In this case, this nylon piece has to fit on there just right. And you put it through the opening. Then we put the washer on there. Add the nut. Try to do this without bumping the camera. Now, I don't really want to turn the fuse holder. I want to turn the nut as opposed to the fuse holder because I don't want to twist that label into a mess that I applied. So yeah, I think that works. Now, in theory, take the cover off. There'll be a fuse inside there. And I'm going to start on this thing. I'm going to start with a 1-amp fast blow, and that should be more than enough long term. The question will be, will a fast blow fatigue and eventually open up just as a nuisance failure? If it does, I'll replace it with a 1-amp slow blow. Now we got the sticker on there, we got the fuse holder mounted. I trimmed that sticker so it fits a little better over here. I think that label looks pretty good. So what we need to do now is just wire this thing up. Now, I have a couple of options here. What I need to do is I need to attach this wire, goes to back to the power switch and eventually to the transformer. This hot wire needs to attach to one of these two terminals. Additionally, the hot wire from this AC inlet jack, that needs to attach to one of them so that when the fuse is in there, these two are effectively tied together and the thing works. Now the question is, which one attaches to which? It would be easiest from the standpoint of having enough wire to reach to attach here, to attach this one here and this one over on the side. However, I've decided to do it the other way around. I could do it either way. There's enough wire to reach either way, but I decided to go the other way around, and the reason for that is because if you look at this fuse holder, there's a electrical connection here, attaches to one side of the fuse, and then deep inside there, if you look in that hole, you'll see another connection inside there. And I want the one that's always connected to the line wire on this AC jack. I want the one that's connected to that, which will always be live if you're plugged in. I want that to be the most recessed one. That way you don't have a risk of ever touching that if you open this up to change the fuse. You know, probably not a big deal, but why not do it that way? Okay, now what I want to do while I solder on this is I want to leave the fuse out so it doesn't have a bunch of thermal fatigue from the soldering. So what I want to do now is I want to take this wire. This is one that we've decided is going to attach to the side terminal on the fuse holder. And I want to trim that clean, strip it back just a little bit. Okay, and ideally I want to wrap it, can't see anything. Ideally I want to wrap it on the same side here and attach it there. So you can see I've got, you know, just enough wire to do that comfortably. And do not forget, because it's easy to do, but don't forget to cut your heat shrink tubing and put it on there before you solder it, because this is your last chance to do that if you want the heat shrink tubing to be there. Okay. And I'm actually going to, at this point, cut two pieces, put them on both wires, and that way I don't have the opportunity to forget and look like an idiot later. So I'm going to put one here, get it back safely out of the way so heat doesn't affect it while I'm soldering. And I'll place the other one here and do the same thing for the same reason. Okay. Got the iron on. It's reasonably hot now. So, going to tin this wire. Just like we did the other one. And while I'm at it, I'm going to take this solder wick, take off the excess. You want enough wire on there to hold the strands together, but not enough wire that it cracks when you bend it and stuff like that. Okay, so this is going to attach right here. To do that, I'm going to bend this out just a little bit. I'm going to bend this little bend in the end of the wire. I'm going to put the wire through there like that. And with a little bit of finagling, I'm going to get this to bite down and give me a good mechanical support. Like that. And I'm going to solder that before I forget. Okay, so that wire is attached. So I'm going to, when it cools down, I'm going to bring back this shrink tubing, put it on there and shrink it down, and then reroute the wire over here with the white wire. But the next step is to get this wire here to attach up here. And we want to do it in such a way that when it all goes together, this wire is not in the way of this post, to whatever extent that's possible. So what I'm doing is I'm just pre-bending this wire here so that it's up and out of the way, so that when it all goes together, there will be plenty of clearance here without hitting this wire. Because this is an always hot wire. You don't want it to be up against a metallic post or something so that it wears through and causes the exact sort of failure that ground bond is there to protect against, the safety ground wire. Okay. So let's cut this to the proper length, or maybe even a little over to start with. The important thing is it's not too short yet. There's always time to make it too short later. There, now it might be too short. Okay, so it's a AWG-14 wire, so we put it in the AWG-14 position on the stripper and strip it back. We'll go a little further than that. Okay. Now, twist our strands and lightly tin it, which in my case seems to be tin the hell out of it, and then go back and suck the excess off. But you do what you gotta do. Okay. Now, per our procedure, we just bend it. Put a little kink in the end of it. And go through like that. and bend it tight so we have mechanical support. And we do. Now, this will be the last bit of soldering I have to do on this job. Okay, so I'm going to tin the iron tip and shut the iron off to save the tip. That way it'll be there for another day. But we've got this done here. All we have to do is shrink these wires, put a zip tie back over there where we cut it off, and test her out. I think it'll be ready to go. So, without further ado, let's do. Now, when I do this, I want to heat these shrink tubing pieces and get them to shrink down, but I also want to make sure I don't melt the plastic fuse holder in the process. So we have a kind of a set of competing requirements here. Okay, I'm going to call that enough. I don't want to go any further. I could shrink it a little bit tighter, but I'd rather not melt the fuse holder since we just went through all this work to put it in. Okay, let's go back out just a little bit. Now, should be able to do that. Let's make sure this wire is out of the way of this post clearance. And there's a little post here that's intended to have these wires tucked under it so that they stay clear of this post. So we should honor that. Go back over here and let's reinstall the zip tie. Now, this is going to be kind of hard to see. So maybe the answer is you won't be able to, but I'm going to put this zip tie through here. Now I'm going to secure these wires all together. And once again, there's a little post here that the wires ideally want to tuck behind to whatever extent that's possible. And tie them all together. That way they stay clear of this hole where the post comes in when you put it together. Now let me trim this. There's one other area of concern that I have, and that, I don't know if you can see it very well, but if you look at, give me something for a pointer, okay, if you look at the body of this switch here, this is the 100/115 volt switch, you'll see that this line cord, this hot wire, runs up and kind of touches that, and I want to put a little bit of clearance in there so it doesn't touch that, because that, once again, if that ever showed up to that, that's the disastrous fault, that the only thing that protects you at that point is that safety bonding wire. So yeah, so as you can see, there's physical space there, and that's always good. And then I tack in the neutral wire, and it is not so critical because there is no significant voltage on that wire, so if it touches it, well, so what, not a big deal. But you know, ideally it doesn't need to touch, so it shouldn't. Okay, I think we're good there. We got our zip tie in. We're almost done here. Okay, we've got our 1 amp, in this case fast blow fuse. Gonna put it in there. Snug it down a little bit. Theoretically, this guy should work when I turn it on. Let's find out. So, to test this guy out, I just want to grab the lamp house that came off of this and making sure I don't touch the glass on the lamp. Plug it in there. Then I take my nasty AC line cord that I keep plugged in and hanging here all the time for testing. Make sure the front switch is off, which it was not, by the way. Okay, if I oriented it right, it helps. I'm not plugged in. Okay, let's make sure the slider is minimum intensity towards the front. Turn the thing on, the light should come on. And now, in theory, that right there proves that the fuse is working, and that light wouldn't have came on, by the way. So now, as you can see, it's working fine. Take these off. Okay, now that we've tested the electrical base and it works, I did one final inspection of the various wires, zip tie down here, the wire routing, the wire here. I made sure that this safety ground connection is to the German standard, that is to say guten tight, so that's done. I checked the shrink tubing here and went back and re-shrunk a few of them. Made them shrink down just a little bit tighter, so I think we have good coverage there. On the back here, the label's nicely seated and trimmed, fuse holders there. And, well, everything's ready to go. Okay, now that we've tested out the electrical base, off camera I went through and checked the collimation of the substage lighting, and it was so close that it was frustrating, because if you're going to take it apart and do all that, you'd like to make an improvement, but in this case I wasn't able to because it was pretty darn close. So anyway, that's done. We're going to put the electrical base on it, and at that point BHTU will be protected and ready to go back into service. So without further ado, let's do it. Oh, I should mention one thing. I thought about this, but I don't think I actually talked about it. But originally, when I took this thing apart, this ground wire, the green and yellow bond wire, was on top on this socket. When I put it back together, I chose to put it together the other way because that made the wiring more accessible, and to me, it makes the wiring flow a little better. So this ground here, if I can get there, this ground is now on the bottom rather than the top. I don't care about that. I guess if anybody did, you could have done it the other way. But I did realize that I didn't mention that aspect. So, but beyond that, I think we're ready to put it together. The better way to do this is actually to lay it down and then just carefully drop it in place like that, and then hold the base in, then lay it on its back. And that's really the recommended way to do that. Now, take my 4mm hex tool, a couple of these screws, line it up so that it looks good, and get the screws started. What I do is I usually snug them down and back them off a little bit. That way they're loose, and I can do a final alignment of this electrical base with respect to the frame before I do the final tightening. Back it off a little bit, and the last one. That one almost wanted to cross thread on me. Okay, so now these are all just a little bit loose. What I do is I look at the spacing around the feet and whatever, and align it so that that's nice and equal. And once it is, then you can tighten it down. So we go back, we snug these four screws. Now, put the lamp house on. The way to do that is to make sure these two pins go in the holes here. These two electrical pins go in the socket here. And when that's all ready, then you just push it in. Okay, so that guy's on. So, one final test just to make sure everything works. Make sure Murphy's not working overtime on me. Let's plug in my bench cord. And I see that the light comes on. I should say the LED comes on. Field adjustment, but you can see the lighting is working. Intensity is being controlled. Everything's good on this scope. So that's it. Thanks for tuning in. I hope there'll be something soon. Thanks.